So glad that you're with us in person, and we're glad that those of you who are with us online. Good morning. Merry Christmas. Praise the Lord. I want you to watch this little clip I've got here. The things that we do for love. The things we do for love. That's the word that's on my heart this morning. The things that we do for love. Bring up that next picture, if you will, Daniel. And that'll move you from crying to laughing and 0 to 60 right there. Watch the thoughts, ladies. We're in church. Y'all, I just thought all these Blue Mountain jokes were jokes, right? Me being born in Blue Mountain. There's your proof right there. There's your proof. I didn't know what to get y'all, so Merry Christmas. Oh, Lord. Yeah, that's me with a mullet. Not just a mullet with a perm. Commitment is one of the things that we do for love. And the Christmas story is a story of commitment. And I think that's why it's fitting. Now, our praise team didn't do Christmas songs, probably not just because the Spirit led them, but probably because we ain't really been able to practice it much in this environment. And Christmas songs are hard to do. They're not something you just sort of pick up and do them again. But the songs they did were just right, because the Christmas story is a story of commitment. And it's more the, when he came as a little baby in a manger, you've got to look at the whole scope of the story to really understand the commitment that was involved. In Luke chapter 1, verse 26, I'm going to read quite a few verses here, if you'll just hang with me here. Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I do not know a man?" And the angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren. For with God, nothing will be impossible." Then Mary said, "Behold, the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. If you will, play the next clip for me. Thank you.
Oh,
John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life." In order for Jesus to make a full sacrifice for us, He made a full commitment. I mean, it wouldn't have been the same if Jesus had just shown up in all of His glory and said, "Here I am to die. Here's my hands, here's my feet, crucify me." He was fully committed in the fact that He took on flesh. Even though He was fully God, He became fully man. And He was born as a vulnerable little baby in a manger, wrapped in swaddling clothes. And you know, we forget about that, but the little child, he grew up to become a toddler. And he grew up to become a child, and then a preteen, and a teen, and a young adult, to become a man in his 30s. He was fully committed to become us, to walk in our shoes, and to be tested and tempted in every way that we could ever be tested and tempted. That is the story of Christmas. It's not just the sweet little Jesus child. It is the full sacrifice and commitment that He made for us. 1 John chapter 5 and 11 says, "This is the testimony that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in His Son." We have life because He gave up His life for us. That is the gospel. That kind of love inspires me. It inspires you. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5 and 14 that the love of Christ constraineth us. Another translation says the love of Christ compels us. Another translation says that the love of Christ controls us. Controls us. The love of God compels me to forget the past. To forget the past. And to continue to move forward. To press on to what He has laid before us. There is no reason to give up, ever. Can you look to the person beside you and say, "There's no reason to give up, ever, ever, ever"? There is no turning back, never, never. He sacrificed for us. His birth to the world, when God gave His Son, was an announcement to us that God was willing to give His very best so that we would not have to die in our sins. That is the greatest miracle that will ever happen. The fact that I can stand in the presence of God and worship Him. The fact that I can stand in the presence of God, in the righteousness of God, in spite of all that I've done and all that I've said, and even the bad motives I had when I did things that looked good. In spite of me, I can stand in God's righteousness because of what He did for me. Praise the Lord for that. The things we do for love, commitment, and sacrifice. I've asked Pastor April to come and to lead us. Before she does that, leads us into communion, I would like us to do something that we do every Christmas. We sing Silent Night together. So I want you to stand. I know what you're thinking, "Pastor, I can't sing." Well, your pastor has a hard time himself. Just picture me with a mullet. You'll forget about your nerves and anxiety. all will be well. And pray that I'll remember how to play the song. So the words are going to be on the screen. Here we go. Sing it. You guys did wonderful. Great job. Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. He was the great I am, that little baby in a manger. He was the King of all kings, that little baby in a manger. He was our Savior, that child, that baby in a manger. Pastor Rapp, if you would come, you would lead us.
Amen. As we take communion today, you know, we are celebrating the greatest gift ever. So many times with Christmas, we are concerned with what to buy and where to buy it and when to get it. Maybe this year, how to ship it, and whether it's going to be here on time, and whether they will like it. And then after Christmas, we're concerned with returning it and standing in line and all of the things. So, so many things. But really, Christmas is so much simpler than we make it. Christmas is about the greatest gift. The gift that was given freely, the greatest gift, the gift that doesn't need to be exchanged, doesn't need to be returned. We don't have to worry about whether it fits. or whether it's going to meet our needs, because He was the greatest gift. God gave the greatest gift. The gift that took care of everything else, every need that we would ever have, the greatest gift was Jesus. And so today, as we think about that, as we take communion, and we think about, as Pastor said, the fact that Jesus was committed. He came as a baby and walked in this life. You know, the Bible says that we have a high priest who's been touched with our infirmities and our needs. He understands hurt. He understands disappointment. He understands joy because He's walked the earth like we've walked. He's walked in our shoes. And so He understands. He understands everything. And that's why He's the greatest gift. That's why He's the best gift. And that's why Christmas is all about Him. Because He was committed to saving us, to taking and doing what was necessary, even though it was hard. And not going halfway and stopping, but being committed to going all the way. He is our Lord, and we are thankful for that. And so today, Father, we come before You, and Lord, we thank You for Your great and amazing gift. We thank You that Christmas is a time to celebrate with family. But more than that, we thank You for the gift of Christmas, the gift that You gave that makes Christmas everything that it is. Thank You, Jesus, for coming as a baby and walking in our shoes. Thank You for taking on our infirmities and our pains and our difficulties, our sicknesses. Thank You for forgiving our sins. Thank You for the suffering that You endured in Your body while on this earth, at the hands of those that You came to save, at the hands of us, the ones, each and every one of us, the ones that You came to present Your life as a gift to, were the ones that brought that suffering upon You. And so today, Lord, we take this communion and we think about the sacrifice that You suffered in Your body for us. And we are thankful for that. We are thankful for the sacrifice that was sufficient, a sacrifice that we could not pay, a price that we could not pay. And we thank You that You gave Your life for us. Thank You that You came, that You walked, that You died, and that You rose again for us. Thank You. Take and eat in remembrance of Jesus' body. Body and for the suffering that You endured for us. But Lord, we are thankful also for Your blood. For Your word says that it is Your blood that cleanses us from our sins, that takes our hearts, and though they be covered in sin and they be dark and dirty, that Your blood will wash us white as snow. It is Your blood, Lord, that has power to give us strength. It is Your blood that has power to give us hope. One drop of Your blood has covered the multitude of many. And we thank You. We thank You for shedding Your blood for us, for each and every one of us. Thank You, Lord, that even when we didn't know our need, even when we were unaware of our sin, even when we were walking in darkness, even before we were even conceived, You came and You gave Your blood to cover all of our needs. And we thank You for that. We thank You for the Christmas gift that You gave you came as a baby knowing what lied ahead. You knew, but yet you continued to walk anyway, knowing that you would shed your blood for us, even when we might not at times be thankful or remember. But today, Lord, we say thank you for the blood that you shed for us. Take and drink in remembrance of his sacrifice and his blood. Thank you, Lord. We give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.